Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about the von Neumann architecture, high-level programming languages, and low-level programming languages. So let's start with the von Neumann architecture. The von Neumann architecture is an important way of looking how computers are programmed. And this was invented by von Neumann. Von Neumann was a mathematician, physicist, and computer scientist, among other things. And he did his PhD in axiomatic set theory. Now, during the Second World War, he worked on the ENIAC and ETVAC projects. You have maybe seen those from the previous video. In these projects, von Neumann developed the notion of a stored procedure computer. But moreover, von Neumann was a pioneer in the notion of self-replication, even before DNA was invented. And he also worked on the hydrogen bomb and invented the concept of mutually assured destruction. Actually, the reason why von Neumann used computers in the first place was to perform simulations of such hydrogen bombs. Further, von Neumann was a pioneer in climate modeling. And he also wrote Foreseeing the Singularity, being a point in time in which technological development changes so fast that we humans no longer are able to catch up. So, let's continue with the von Neumann architecture. The von Neumann architecture is a way of building computers out of components. The most important components are the processing unit, the control unit, random access memory, so that's memory that can be addressed randomly. It is a continuous storage of data, and the address allows you to point in that space and pull out the data at an arbitrary point. And further, the architecture consists of external components allowing you to store data and perform input and output. Important of this architecture is the way that the processing unit and the control unit interact. The processing unit can be understood to consist of devices that perform arithmetic and logical operations. And further, the processing unit consists of very short-term memory called registers. The control unit, on the other hand, consists of an instruction register and a program counter. The instruction register contains the information of an instruction to execute, and the program counter is a point somewhere in the long in the random access memory where it will retrieve instructions from. The basic operation of a von Neumann computer repeats the following three steps. The first step is to fetch an instruction from the random access memory by looking at what data is stored in that memory at the position of the program counter. Now, after fetching this data from the memory and storing it in the instruction register, the computer then decodes the instruction. Decoding means that it analyzes the data comprising that instruction, which allows it to enable and disable certain functionality of the processing unit. So whenever then the instruction is executed, it means that the processing unit performs its function. After the processing unit has performed the function, the control unit takes over again and it increases the program counter to the next position in memory. But depending on the output or the operation of the processing unit, it may also jump and change the program counter into a different location than the next. So to see how current computers also look like that of von Neumann's, let's have a look at the notion of low-level programming languages. A low-level programming language comes out of this stored procedure computer. You can imagine that you have data that represents the instructions, and these are encoded numerically, but that makes it very difficult for a human to understand how the instructions work. So, a crucial insight is as soon as instructions and data are stored in the same memory, that we can then make programs themselves that produce programs. So the idea here is that you have a program which reads in maybe a human-readable piece of text and outputs the instructions as the machine understands. And this program is called an assembler. To give you a concrete example of how an assembler looks like, let's consider the following example. So many modern devices, such as desktops, laptops, but also mobile phones, use an assembly language designed by Intel. It's called the Intel x86 assembly language. So here on the screen you see a number of instructions, and these instructions are written in the low-level programming language because they're humanly readable. You see the text. Now, an assembler takes this piece of text as input and it translates it into the encoding of these instructions as the machine can execute them. So, to explain you a little bit about what is the program written here, imagine that each of the lines corresponds to one particular instruction. So then the machine starts when it executes this program with the first, and then it decodes the instruction, after the assembler has performed the translation of this text into the instruction stream. But I'll talk about as if it happens on the text because that's easier to explain. So the first instruction is executed, and then the computer moves to the second instruction by increasing the program counter by one. After executing the second, it continues to the third, etc. So to show you concretely how it works, suppose that we execute the first instruction. This instruction indicates that the processing unit must store the value 2 in the register that has the name EAX. Then, after the processing unit completes, the control unit takes over and it moves the program counter to the next instruction. Now, the next instruction is fetched, and the next instruction indicates what next to perform. Well, in this case, to move the value 3 into the register named EBX. So, by moving 3 into EBX, the processing unit does not change the value of the other registers. So at this point in time, we know that the register EAX has value 2 and the register EBX has value 3. So when the control unit increases the program counter and fetches the next instruction, IMUL EBX, it indicates to the processing unit to take the current value of EAX and multiply it by the value that is stored in EBX. Well, we know that the current value of EAX is 2 and the current value of EBX is 3, so the multiplication of those is 6. And this result is then stored in the register EAX and the instruction is completed. Control goes back and the program counter is increased, so we go to the next instruction. This instruction interrupts, and an interrupt is a way for the computer to indicate to the components surrounding it, say the input-output components, that they have to perform a particular function. In this case, you can assume that int1 means to print the value on some output device that is currently stored in the register EAX. And we already know that it contains 6, so you would expect the output to be 6. We go to the next instruction, which is the halt instruction. The halt instruction is a special instruction because whenever it is executed, it does nothing. And when the control then has to move the program counter to the next instruction, it does not do that. It instead remains at the same position. So the computer then, in the next step, again fetches the halt instruction, it does nothing, and it stays at the same position. So this means that the machine is in the same state and it remains in the same state. So sometimes this instruction is called halt and catch fire because it basically does nothing and it is stuck at this instruction while wasting energy. Now, if you click on this link, then you see a web-based simulator and you can copy or type over this program in it and experiment with the assembly language. So that gives you an idea of a low-level programming language. It is a programming language that is used to give instructions to the machine to execute. However, low-level programming is tedious and error-prone. You have to manage the details of the execution all by yourself. And you can make mistakes very easily. So that has led to the development of higher level programming languages. So higher programming languages are just like low level programming languages typically considered to be a piece of text. And again, we have the idea that we can have programs that themselves produce programs. So you can imagine a sort of a pipeline in which you have multiple programs, each producing a lower level programming language, until at the end you end up with the assembler which produces the instructions that the machine can execute. So a program that takes a high level programming language and then transforms it into a low-level programming language is typically called a compiler. Now, there are alternative ways of executing programming languages. It is not necessary to execute a program to make this translation all the way into the low-level encoding of instructions that a machine can execute. You can also write a simulator. A simulator directly works on the program as it is given by the user, so the piece of text, and it analyzes the text, and it performs the commands or the statements or the declarations as given in the text directly. So these kinds of programs are called interpreters. Of course, it is also possible to have a combination of the two. So to have a compiler that translates up to some intermediary format, and that intermediary format then is interpreted. Alternatively, you could dynamically choose when to interpret or when to compile into the machine format that the machine that you're running on expects. There are these hybrids. To give you an idea of existing programming languages and how they relate to these three concepts, consider, for example, the programming language C. It is considered a higher level programming language. The input of the C compiler is a program written in the C programming language. The compiler then translates the program as you input into assembly. So this is the assembly you saw on the previous slide. Then another program comes and that translates the assembly code into an instruction stream as the machine understands. Now it is an interesting design decision of the C language that it abstracts away from the particular details of the machine that executes. So that means that when you write a program in the C programming language, you do not necessarily know to what instructions your C program corresponds. Furthermore, certain compilers, such as modern C compilers, have a lot of techniques built into them that perform optimizations. The program text is analyzed, and the most efficient, or at least approximately the most efficient, or as far as we know the most efficient, machine code comes out of the whole process. Another example of a high-level programming language is C++. Originally, it was defined as a language that would then be compiled by translating a C++ program into a C program. And then you can use the C compiler on the resulting C program to translate it into assembly. And then you can use an assembler to translate the result into the machine code that the machine can execute. Later, the C++ compiler immediately translated into assembler. Another example of a high-level programming language is Java. It is a typical example of a hybrid language in the sense of being in between a compiled language and an interpreted language. The Java compiler takes a piece of program text and translates it into an intermediary format called Java bytecode. The Java bytecode then is the input to a program called the Java Virtual Machine. It is a simulator. The Java Virtual Machine takes in the bytecode and it simulates, thereby executing the program. However, modern Java virtual machines have built in a technique which is called just-in-time compilation. Whenever it detects that a part of the program that it keeps on interpreting is executed a lot, it starts off a compilation process. This compilation process then compiles the bytecode as it is executing a lot into the machine format that the machine you are currently running on is accepts. And once this compilation process is done, whenever you then want to execute the bytecode again, it now executes the compiled version of the same code, which increases the efficiency of the execution a lot. Another example of a programming language that is high level is JavaScript. So JavaScript is typically interpreted. Well, it used to be interpreted. Because nowadays, in modern web browsers such as Google Chrome, with the V8 JavaScript engine, the programs are again interpreted, just like in Java, but whenever it's executed a lot, or whenever some kind of analysis process detects that the program piece is important, it also starts a compilation process. Now, think about Java and JavaScript as allowing you to write programs, and this used to be a motto, or still is a motto of Java, but especially it's important for JavaScript, because it allows you to write a program and then execute it on a wide variety of machines. Different machines with their different processing units have different instruction formats. So the same encoding of instructions cannot be reused by different machines. However, Java using its intermediary bytecode, or JavaScript, which uses directly the source language, can be executed on many different machines. By re-implementing the simulator in the case of Java, or in the case of V8, by implementing it for different kinds of computer architectures, you can use the same program text to specify the behavior of a wide variety of machines. Now, it is an interesting development that some subset of the JavaScript language itself is nowadays used to express low-level operations. Such as, for instance, whenever you have a website that has JavaScript code that wants to draw on the screen. To make this more efficient, the developers of the JavaScript engine have isolated a subset which could be safely translated into the instruction format of the machine that it runs on. And thereby you have this whole chain of compilation processes, making it easier for the programmer to directly express how the end result looks like in terms of assembly language. This is called WebAssembly. So as you see, we started with low-level programming languages, and then over the years we found out that they were tedious and error-prone to program, so we introduced higher-level languages. These had additional benefits because it allows you to run the same program on multiple different devices. But then to regain performance of the execution of the program, later there were subsets of these languages such as WebAssembly that then allows you to regain regain the efficiency of the low-level programming languages again. So this is a very short introduction to the notions of low-level and high-level programming languages. In the book of Sebesta, you can read more about this. Thank you for watching this video and hope to see you soon.